I'm sure all of you are waiting to hear who won the Hindu Prize 2016. But before we get to that, we have one more prize to give away. Many of you would have watched the college students enacting excerpts from the shortlisted novels yesterday. This initiative, which was a brainchild of our consultant, Prasanna Ramaswamy, has helped the Lit for Life connect with the city's student community. The dramatization was facilitated by city's theatre group Kriya Shakti, and for this we are very grateful to Dushyant Gunashekar. We'd also like to thank Samyukta PC for judging yesterday's event. May I now ask Dr. Nirmala Lakshman, Director, Kasturi & Sons Limited and Lit for Life, to give away the trophies to the winning colleges. Please come up on stage, ma'am. And now for the winners, the first prize, an adaptation of Manjula Padmanabhan's The Island of Lost Girls, goes to Women's Christian College, Chennai. Can I have the representatives of the team come up, please? The second prize, an adaptation of Anil Menon's Half of What I Say, goes to SSN College of Engineering. Thank you, everyone. Moving on to the Hindu Prize. Instituted in 2010 to honor the best of Indian writing in English, the Hindu Prize stands proud and equal to many other coveted literary prizes. Now, the shortlisted authors. May I have the AV, please? Now have readings from the shortlisted novels by the authors. May I invite Anil Menon, Kiran Doshi, Kunal Basu and Manjula Padmanabhan to the stage. Unfortunately, Hansda Sowvendra Shekhar is unable to come today because of a difficult situation at his hospital in Jharkhand. But we have the four authors. Anil Menon's Half of What I Say is a complex, intricate narrative that shows how the nation uses subterfuge to short-circuit its own rule of law in the service of operations aimed against enemies of the state. Over to you, Anil.
So this is going to be an interesting moment because I only read half the email that told me that I was going to read an excerpt from my novel. So I'm going to read from my phone instead. So this is the first chapter of Half of What I Say. And it begins with a speech by a politician slash writer figure, Durga Dasal. And it begins like this. I'm Durga Dasal. I'm glad to be here to share your special moment. And it is a special moment. You're graduating from Delhi University, a fine university by any standard, especially your standard, since you are now finished with it and need a job. Laughter. Yes, this is a sunlit day, an important day, and a day whose memory will provide a pale warmth for the rest of your short, competitive, ulcer-ridden lives. I'm joking. I look at you and think, what great new beginnings, what stories waiting to be told, what worlds waiting to be made. It's great to be out of college, isn't it? No doubt it's scary, but it's great to be in that stage of your life where you have inserted the key into the ignition and are about to start the engine. Take it from me. There is no other moment quite like it. So give yourself a big hand. Applause. I remember it was a great day for me as well. I too was wondering what my future was going to be like. I didn't know it was going to involve hair implants. Laughter. While you were in college, see, I already used the past tense. When you were in college, I'm sure you had all these great late-night conversations on the meaning of life, the existence of God, what's wrong with politics, and so on. Later on, as we settle into our jobs, marriages, adulthood, we seem to forget we were interested in these questions. Sometimes we think about those conversations and smile nostalgically. How passionate we were, how idealistic, how much time we wasted on unanswerable questions. Suppose you are in an office meeting and the boss asks, what's the next item on the list? Do you think you will reply, finding myself? Laughter. Yet in college, we can say these crazy things and dream these crazy things without feeling we are crazy. Or we know we are crazy, but sanity is not that big a deal. Look around you, boy. You know more than half your friends probably should be locked up. The conversations, these conversations, kapats, adhas, gapshap, my generation called them, are what you will miss the most. Sure, we can call our friends whenever we like, but it's not the same as lying on your friend's katmal-ridden bistar, snarfing down his homemade laddus, knowing you should be studying for the electronics final, but instead arguing about whether Dara Singh could beat Rambo in a UFC fight. For many of you, it's the first time you got to really know somebody who is not a school friend or a blood relation. They may be from a different state, a different language, be of a different gender, had experiences you didn't think were possible, and have opinions that leave you speechless with disbelief. They're completely different from you, and you wouldn't have your best friends any other way. You find yourself growing like you had never grown before. So how do we keep growing? Surely it can't end with college. Surely we can't reserve it for a few out-of-life weekends.
Jinnah often came to our house by Kiran Doshi, draws from politics and history, and fuses them with the existential dilemmas of individuals and communities. It also offers insights into some of the greatest personalities of the subcontinent in the 20th century. Ladies and gentlemen, Kiran Doshi.
The chapters I have selected are from the 10th chapter, subtitled 1907-1908, dealing with the great trial of Lokmanya Tilak for sedition. The two fictional characters in the book are husband and wife pair, Sultan and Rehana. Sultan's practice was doing well, but Jinnah's was doing better, and that Rehana knew rankled. Oddly, he was also fond of Jinnah, but it also gave him much pleasure whenever Jinnah lost a case, as even Jinnah did at times. Tilak has been sentenced to 6 years in exile. He said to Rehana when he returned home from the High Court, the night the judgment against Tilak was passed, served him right for going to Jinnah. But I thought he had parted from Mr. Jinnah early in the case, she said, and finally conducted his own defense. Yes, Sultan conceded. They had differences. Tilak is a stubborn man. Jinnah is worse, if anything. For him, it is either his way or no way. That may be fine in a freedom fighter, Sultan chuckled at his own choice of words, but hardly so in a lawyer. A lawyer does not desert his client midstream, He brings him round, tactfully. Courtrooms are slippery places. For a man to defend himself, that too in a case of sedition, is like stepping on a banana peel. In the end, all the Tilak could do was to appeal to the Almighty. "Oh," she said. "Exactly," he said. "No feather in Jinnah's cap this time." They did not make love that night. She said she was tired. But she lay awake in the darkness. Heavy showers of rain had fallen intermittently the whole evening, drenching the thousands of people who had gathered outside the High Court for the Tilak verdict, finally delivered at 10 in the night. It fell incessantly now, as if the skies too were weeping. Where would they send him, she wondered? To that horrible jail in the Andamans? To England? To Burma? Where the British exiled the last Mughal emperor exactly 50 years ago? Would he survive the long exile or die of a broken heart like the emperor? What would happen to the struggle against the British if he died? What would happen to the struggle now with him out of the way? And Bombay, her beloved Bombay, what would happen to Bombay? Bombay erupted the next day. Thousands of people poured out into the streets, shouting slogans against the British, carrying placards of Bande Mataram, Tilak Zindabad, Swaraj is my birthright. The government reacted the only way it knew. It banned gatherings. When people gathered nevertheless, it ordered them to disperse. When they did not disperse, it let loose water hoses on them, lathi charged them, ran mounted police to them, fired on them. Many people lost their lives. Many were exiled. Through all the turmoil, there was not a single communal riot in Bombay. Rehana was sure that it was because of Jinnah. He was not just the best-known Mohammedan man in public life, but also one of the most important Congress leaders. And there was not a leader of any newspaper, reader of any newspaper in the whole of Bombay, in fact, in the whole of India, who did not know what Jinnah was and what he stood for. Everybody knew that he was fighting tooth and nail the devious British design to divide and rule India. Thank you.
Kunal Basu's Calcutta portrays lives lived on the brink in a convincing and insightful manner. It has a wealth of details about those marginalized by the city's elite. Kunal, stage is yours.
This is how the novel begins. Blood tastes bitter, mixed with dirt. The night was checkered with shadows when they caught me, trapped me rather, with a call from the roadside, the call of a friend. A hand held out my favorite menthol filters. Bodies huddled on the pavement like a cricket team before the start of a match. A bus came to a screeching stop and blocked the crossing for a minute. Then it was all clear between us. That minute was what it took to make up my mind, to have a smoke with Rakib and the gang. Maybe a glass of thandai afterwards, spiked with bhang. They will kill me one day, I thought as I went over to the tea shop. If you know my friends, you should be prepared for a few jokes and more than a few bad words. They take my mother's name, ape my sister dragging along her crippled foot, make a farting sound and cover their noses, pretending to be Abbu, my father who farted just as badly as their fathers. How did a gas bomb produce a gem like you? One of them borrowed my comb and strummed its teeth like a guitar. A menthol was slipped in between my fingers. No one asked where I was going, if I was on my way to meet a party, or if the star fucker of Hindustan had a rare night off, out sniffing the poison of the streets. There are days when your friends turn into your worst enemies. Today was such a day. Later, I'd remember the few words that were spoken before the beating started. Calm reminders of facts, indisputable and honest. A punishment meted out with sincerity. Every slap, punch, and chop kicks under the belly, a rock smashed on my head. No mother's cunt or sister's cunt, mind you. No name calling. No one trying to show off and outdo others, lined up nicely like goody-goody boys awaiting their turn. The shop owner looked away, poured milk from one steaming pot into another to build up a froth. A loafer or two took off once they caught sight of blood. Whatever they were expecting, there was no drama from my side. Going down like a goat to slaughter, repaying in full debts from a previous life. No begging for mercy to Rakib, whose father had reached his grave on my shoulders. Not to Yakub, the orphan I had saved from agents before they could sell him off to the Gulf. Bobby the Anglo-Indian, the one with a bad habit of losing bets and begging his money back. Friends of friends who until last night were ready to lick my ass for a chance to join my business. Under pressure, the brain works like a stopwatch, counting moments, but forgets about beginnings and ends. When's the interval? It asks like a thirsty child or someone bursting inside his pants. Maybe they will stop when tea is ready. Or after they have done what they have threatened to do before. Part my jaws and cleave out my tongue with a razor. What better way to punish a rotten gigolo? Head jammed between their legs, you get to see only the ground close to your nose. And know to be true what Ammi had told us long ago, that the streets of Calcutta were paved half and half with dirt and gold.
Manjula Padmanabhan's The Island of Lost Girls documents something sinister in today's gender relations. It also points to our need to reinvent ourselves using a different imagination. Manjula.
The excerpt I'm going to read takes place kind of in the middle of the book. The protagonist is a young woman called Meiji. She grew up surrounded by men in a country where all the women had been eliminated. She is now on an island populated exclusively by girls and women. All the girls are the survivors of terrible physical abuse. In this scene, Meiji has just been told that on the island there is a policy of erasing memories. But it was wrong, protested Meiji. They took our memories without asking. And now I have nothing but my name. I don't know who I am. I don't know where I am. I don't know where I came from. And that is a good thing, said Rahim, their leader, forcefully. What is inside the old memory is useless stuff, burning, stinking. If we know what that memory is, we is not sleep, we is not work, we is do nothing but scream. Yes, said Meiji, but there is no but. You is here now. You is part of team. You is safe. Safe? Said Meiji bitterly. What is safe? When strangers can reach inside my brain and take away whatever there is, whatever they want? It's for your own good, said one of the other girls, Alari. Can you not see that? Whatever they do is for our good. We are lucky to be here. Lots of other girls are not so lucky. Meiji's brow creased slightly and she opened her mouth. Then she shut it again. What is your thought? Asked Rahim. Speak now. We is have time. I just, said Meiji, well, I'm not the same as you, all of you. Look, she said, extending her arms in front of her, I have no scars, no tattoos, no decorations. My feet and hands are my own. Everyone else here, she glanced around, everyone else here has real scars, surgery, amputation, implants. She couldn't find the words. Your bodies are cut and changed, added to or taken out from everyone except me. So, said Alari, Her voice came from an implant, and the scar tissue on her face skewed her expression so that she seemed to be smiling, though she was not. What do you think? That you're better than us? Not better, insisted Meiji, just different. Anyway, it doesn't matter, said one of the other girls, Messina. If you're here, it means something very bad happened to you in the past. Why do you want to know? It's over now. No, if I don't know what happened to me, it's the same thing as Meiji struggled to find words. I mean, don't you want to know what happened to you? Don't you care that parts of your body have been taken away? Messina shook her head and shoulders in vehement denial. No, I don't care. Why do you? Allery said, just by being here, you are the same as us. What's wrong with you perhaps can't be seen, that's all, but it must be horrible, or else you wouldn't be here. You should be glad you don't know what it is. Raham remained silent, biting her lips. Meiji said, that's just the point. How can I know if it was horrible or not horrible? If I don't know what it was, why can't I choose? Because you must have trust, said Raham now. She straightened her back, asserting her position as leader. Trust in the mentors. They know what is good for you, for all of us. We is on island now. We is grow strong. We is grow in power. If you is do good, maybe you is even grow into mentor. But out there, she said, pointing in the direction of the window, in the zone, you is have nothing. No protections, no help. You is alone, you is lone woman. And woman alone in zone is need big time protections. A frown creased Meiji's forehead. What is it? Asked Ram. Meiji shook her head, unable to talk. A powerful tremor was building up inside her. But the other girls were staring at her, had trained their gaze on her like laser torches, and she knew she had to say something. She said, You call me a woman, she said. Raham looked surprised and said, yeah, so what? Meiji stammered as she said, She realized she was about to jump into a pool of molten shame, but she had no choice. I'm not a woman. I'm a person. There was a fraction of silence, and then the others began to laugh. Shaya said, ha, no wonder you don't feel afraid to know what's happened to you. You don't know what you are. Messina gave out a harsh cackle. She said, she thinks she's a man. A man, a man. The team gave in to hoots and barking shrieks of laughter. Meiji blinked rapidly in confusion. No, she said, no, of course I'm not. She knew exactly what men were, and she was perfectly aware that she wasn't one. The others were still laughing. If you're not a man, and you're not a woman, shrieked Messina, what are you? She rocked from side to side, howling with laughter so hard that her seat folded up beneath her. She fell on the floor with a bump, which caused the others to collapse in another round of laughter. Meiji did not share in their mirth. She heard herself say, I'm a person. Her inner self was crumbling. A person, she said again, in desperation and misery, clinging to the words as if to a flimsy lifeline in a blizzard of uncertainty. Thank you.
I now invite our jury to take their seats on stage. May I invite Professor Satchidanandan, V Ramakrishnan, Anamika, and Manu Chakravarthy to please come up. Our chief guest for the award is Pulitzer Prize winning author Geraldine Brooks. As foreign correspondent for the Wall Street Journal, Ms. Brooks has covered crises in Africa, Balkans, and West Asia. Her book, Nine Parts of Desire, based on her experiences with Muslim women in West Asia, was translated into 17 languages. She won the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction for her novel March. Ma'am, we're very honored that you are our chief guest today. May I request you to come on stage, please? Dr. Nirmala Lakshman will escort ma'am to the stage. Professor Satchidanandan, the chairperson of the jury, will now take you all through the judging process and the shortlist.
Dear fellow jurors, dear friends, let me at the very outset congratulate the shortlisted authors, all of whom we found wonderfully good and really brilliant. I will say something about the process of selection and also a bit about the works that have been shortlisted, after which the winner will be announced. We started with around 60 books. We have a five-member jury. Unfortunately, Pradeep Sebastian, who is in the United States, couldn't fly in. We have Anamika, we have V Ramakrishnan, we have Manu Chakravarthy, who are present here. As I said, we started with 60 books, and in the beginning, we divided these books among ourselves. Then we began to recommend to one another, and practically all of us ended up reading almost all the books. And it was not very difficult, in fact, to choose the five books from the 60 books. Perhaps it was a little more difficult to choose the winner, as it always happens. Because the general crop this year, I would not say was very great, but definitely the five books we have shortlisted, we have no doubt about their essential quality and their contribution to the genre of fiction. Because we were looking first for the contribution of this particular work to the art of fiction, to the genre, the style, the way it dealt with existence and its various conflicts and dimensions, the way it engaged its engagement with history, with life, public life in general. And indeed, the novelty and the freshness of the theme and the presentation. That's how we came to this shortlist. And the novel, you have some idea of the novels which have been shortlisted because some excerpts have already been read. So I'll make short comments on each of these works from which I think parts were already read out. It's purely in the alphabetical order. Half of What I Say by Anil Menon, which is a complex and intricate narrative that shows how the nation state uses subterfuges to short circuit its own rule of law in the service of operations aimed at the enemies of the state. This work is a meta narrative on the bizarre forces that operate overtly and covertly, impacting the very fabric of our social, cultural, and political life. The novel moves in strange directions and in unexpected ways to uncover the forces that converge to establish a powerful nexus that annihilates centers of sanity and balance in the lives of individuals and societies. At several levels, the work is outrageously unconventional, though firmly rooted in the history of our times. The use of multiple perspectives of narration and the self-reflexive elements in storytelling add to the narrative's aesthetic richness. And the second one, Gina Often Came to Our House by Kiran Doshi. It's a novel that begins in the early part of the 20th century and ends with the partition and independence. It has a rare epic soup. Historical figures like Jinnah and Gandhi mingle with unknown figures who too had played a role in shaping history. The larger question regarding what motivates people to act in a certain way at crucial moments is set against the political turmoil of the subcontinent. The work, with its strong ethical core, draws from politics and history in the context of the nationalist phase and fuses them with the existential dilemmas of individuals and communities. Equally remarkable is the manner in which the work, with its unbiased wisdom, corrects all kinds of prejudices about political leaders and religious communities and properly situates the confrontation between the moderates and the extremists defining the period. Women characters here are created, are treated with extreme empathy, and the style has an undercurrent of irony, and the descriptions articulate what is left unsaid by the characters. The novel offers insights into some of the great personalities of the subcontinent in the 20th century and looks forward to the future. Calcutta by Kunal Basu. The character of Jamshed Alam takes us to the underbelly of Calcutta, peopled with exiles and refugees. This part of the city is violent and volatile, making the great artistic heritage of the city a distant illusion. Kunal Basu's portrayal of lives lived on the brink is convincing and insightful. Characters like Miriam, Mandira, and Rani pose questions about contemporary life that are hard to answer. The narrative has a wealth of details about lives marginalized by the city elite. The Adivasi Will Not Dance by Hansda Sowvendra Shekhar. These stories, set in the interior rural hinterland of tribal belt in Jharkhand, bring out the tragic struggle of the Adivasis to eke out a living on the margins of small towns. There is no attempt to idealize the Adivasis. The tales reveal the author's inside knowledge of their customs and rituals. The language is stark and free from sentimentality. Generally, the stories are told with great compassion, yet with remarkable objectivity. And The Island of Lost Girls by Manjula Padmanabhan. Manjula's is a dystopian novel about the fate of women in a patriarchal society. She employs the narrative mode of science fiction. Through harrowing episodes and searing scenes, the novel documents something sinister in the making of gender relations in contemporary life and points to our need to reinvent ourselves using a different kind of imagination. Let me once again thank my fellow jurors who have been extremely responsible and alert, and also once again let me conduct the shortlist of this. Thank you.
It's my great honor to be invited to announce the winner of this prize. As an Australian, a representative of perhaps one of the younger literary traditions on the planet, it's astonishing to be asked to present a prize to a representative of one of the more venerable and richest literary traditions on the planet. It's a privilege to be a writer and to have readers come to a festival like this one. I think of us as a sorority, a club of storytellers that extends back through the past. When I was reading to my sons when they were young, a wonderful little book called A Little History of the World by an Austrian historian, an art historian called Hans Gombrich. He describes writing about the past in a very particular way that I wanted to share with you. He says, when you think about the past, it's like imagining lighting a piece of paper and dropping it into a very dark well. And as the paper drops, the less is illuminated. Living memory gives way to archives, archives to archaeological records, until the paper has dropped so far that the light has gone out and all is dark. But the story didn't end there. Even when the archaeological record falls silent, you can be sure that there were people sitting around fires somewhere telling each other stories. Behind every once upon a time is another grandmother or grandfather. My grandmother, her grandmother's grandmother, back into that dark place in the well. But always behind every once upon a time is another once upon a time. And I'm very proud to be in that tradition of storytellers and proud to be here with these great writers today. I think that fiction is critical, and particularly when we're facing troubled contemporary times. I know it's important because I've seen how the despots and the jailers fear it. When I was working as a reporter on the West Bank, a young Palestinian boy stoned my car one day, and I jumped out and interviewed him. He told me his story, and we became friends. And when he was arrested and sent to jail, as was almost inevitable in the case of a youth like that, I tried to send him some books because I knew he loved reading English. So I chose Ernest Hemingway's The Old Man and the Sea because I thought its simple language would be accessible to him and I thought he would love the story. But the jailers wouldn't allow him to have it. They didn't want him to have the release into the freedom of ideas. And I thought about that boy when I was interviewing Michael Murray, who was one of the military lawyers defending a man incarcerated in Guantanamo. And he had tried to give his client the novel To Kill a Mockingbird. But likewise, the jailers were afraid of what that book might mean for an incarcerated mind. They were afraid of the words. He also told me that in the few letters his client was allowed to receive, the word love was always redacted. It enrages me to hear these stories, but as a writer, it's what gets me up in the morning. I'm intensely motivated by this. I'm glad that jailers and despots fear the power of words, because that is the power that we as writers and you as readers will always have. Our minds cannot be incarcerated. So with that, I would just finish by saying that Rachna told me that this festival is held during Pongal because that's when we can get the school for 3 days. But I think there's a wonderful synchronicity to the fact that this festival is held at a time that is celebrating a harvest of food. Because just as important as grains of rice, I think, is the food of the mind. And what a feast we've had here over the last 2 days. So thank you for inviting me, and thank you for the honor of being able to tell you now that the winner of the Hindu Prize is the novel Jinnah Often Came to Our House by Kiran Doshi.
I'm overwhelmed, but I'll try and find some words. I'm a senior citizen. In the words of my banker and my chartered accountant, soon to become a senior citizen. To those who are not senior citizens here, I can share a secret. it's not such a bad thing to be old. The words of Longfellow come to my mind. Age has as many compensations, as many opportunities as youth itself, though in a different dress. For when the evening twilight fades away, the stars come out, invisible by day. My oldest memory of participating in a public event goes back to 1945 or 46, and is in fact that of Madras, as it was then called. My great-grandfather was almost the first settler, Gujarati settler, in Madras. He's the one who gave Shau Carpet its name. My grandfather was the president of the Gujarat Mandal. And as the president of Gujarat Mandal, it was his honor to hold a reception in honor of Mahatma Gandhi. And who else would have the honor of garlanding Mahatma Gandhi than me? I was asked to toddle up to Mahatma Gandhi, garland in hand. And to be swept up by him and given a hug. It was what you'd call today a great photo opportunity. So, as it happened, there was a relative with a camera, box camera, and he took a 2-inch by 2-inch black and white photograph of that. That was the first of many photo opportunities in my life. I've had a lucky life, full of events, which triggered off full of enthusiasms, many enthusiasms. And at 35 years of diplomacy, and almost 10 years of education after that, I had to do many things. I also did many things which I didn't particularly have to do, but I did them nevertheless. As Frank Sinatra would say, I did it my way. I was not always successful, but I was successful many times. And so there were many photo opportunities in my life. There were rewards. None of them means more to me today than this award. I have not written my memoirs. I probably never write them. This is the closest I've come to writing my memoirs. It took me 3 years to write that, almost 8 hours a day. The two great inspirations for that were, one, what I learned of India's foremost external plus internal problem. It's called Pakistan. I had to deal with Pakistan many times. I think I know Pakistan almost as well as I know, as anybody would. I was even posted there. There was one great inspiration in my life. The other great inspiration was the dowry that I got when I married my wife. The dowry didn't come just off her being a medico from Christian Medical College in Vellore, or the fact that we were college sweethearts. We met 61 years back. And the moment she saw me, she just ran into my arms. This is another story. That was because we were in a college trip to southern India, and we were all in Mysore, watching the Maharaja Wadiyar on an elephant in front of a procession. They had cordoned off the main street. But my wife is very bold. She's still very bold. She was very bold then. She went out beyond the ropes to watch the Maharaja, the elephant, and all the marchers after that. We didn't know each other at that time. I stood on the other side of the ropes under a tree, along with other students from Bombay. But suddenly, after the Maharaja's procession had gone, and my wife was still out there, they released the bulls. And as they released the bulls, she ran to the first person she could find, there was me, came into my arms and said, "Help me." So of course I helped her and helped myself a bit too. And so that's how we met. My wife's grandfather, dowry, now coming to the dowry, my wife's grandfather, maternal grandfather, was a barrister. Barrister Azad is a name I borrowed for my book. Barrister Azad was a friend and contemporary of Jinnah. He was apolitical, but his daughter, my wife's mother, was not. And even in primary, elementary school, she was a freedom fighter. She sang Bande Mataram. Her name was Umrao Beg, to whom the book has been dedicated. She wore khadi. She was thrown out of the convent school because she was supposed to sing God Save the King instead of Bande Mataram. But she went on to join the Grand Medical College and set up a hospital named after the great Tilak in an area populated by poorer people, and a hospital treated them for free. So that was my other great stream that went into the writing of this novel. And there were many other inspirations, but then one great inspiration, which I mentioned at the very end of the book, I won't take any more time, that is that of Francis Bacon, the Francis Bacon. I ran into a sentence by him, and then I started writing this book. The sentence was, "Sometimes truth is so hard to tell, it is fiction to make it sound probable." So thank you very much again. I want to thank the jurors for seeing merit in the book. I want to thank the Hindu for giving the umbrella for this. I want to thank Dr. Nirmalaji for a fantastic festival. I've enjoyed every minute of that. I just wish I had, like Lord Krishna, two roops. I could go from one place to another. I couldn't cover all of them, but I really enjoyed every minute of that. And to say thank you means do it again, do invite us again. I may not write another book. Thank you very much. And above all, I want to thank my publishers, Westlands, also from Chennai, that they saw the book for what it was before I had even finished 50 pages. And they converted what was a rough diamond by the time I had finished the book into the gem that it became. Thank you very much. Thank you all of you.